Hare Krishna. So I'll just recite the verse. Only few verses are remaining in this chapter, and this is the main verse with the purport. Others are like just telling the towards the concluding the this episode of Daksha's Yajna. So I'll just recite this 55th verse and we'll discuss on this, and then next time maybe you can start a new chapter.
त्रयाणामेकभावानां यो न पश्यति वैभिदां सर्वभूतात्मानं ब्रह्मन् स शान्तिम् अधिगच्छति.
So I think this is 54 we did, 55 today. Next verse.
मैत्री अवाच एवं भगवता दिष्टः प्रजापति पतिर् हरिम् हर्षित्वा क्रतुना स्वेना देवानुभयतो अजयत.
Translation and purport by His Divine Grace A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. Translation. The sage Maitreya said, thus, Daksha, the head of all Prajapatis, having been nicely instructed by the Supreme Personality of Godhead, worshipped Lord Vishnu. After worshipping him by performing the prescribed sacrificial ceremonies, Daksha separately worshipped Lord Brahma and Lord.
Hare Krishna.
Yes, Mataji, we cannot hear.
Oh, okay, I thought I myself dropped. Maybe we can wait some time.
Hare Krishna, can all of you hear me?
Oh, we can hear you now.
Okay. I'll read the purport. Lord Vishnu should be offered everything and his prasad should be distributed to all the demigods. This practice still followed in the temple of Jagannath at Puri. There are many temples of demigods around the main temple of Jagannath, and the prasad, which is offered first to Jagannath, is distributed to all the demigods. The deity of Bhagali is worshipped with the prasad of Vishnu. And also in the famous Lord Shiva temple at Bhubaneswar, the prasad of Lord Vishnu or Lord Jagannath is offered to the deity of Lord Shiva. This is the Vaishnava principle. The Vaishnava does not deride even ordinary living entities, including the small ant. Everyone is offered proper respect according to his position. The offering, however, is in relation to the center, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Krishna or Vishnu. The devotee who is highly elevated sees the relationship to Krishna and everything. He does not see anything as being independent of Krishna. That is his version of oneness.
ओम ज्ञान तिमिरंदस्य ज्ञानंजन शलाके चक्षुरोन्मिलितं येन तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः. श्री चैतन्य मनोभीष्टं स्थापितं येन भूतले स्वयं रूप कदा मह्यं ददाति स्वपदांतिकं वंदेहं श्री गुरु श्रीयुता पदकमलं श्री गुरुन् वैष्णवांश श्री रूपं सागरजातं सहगना रघुनाथांवितं तं सजीवम् अद्वैतं सावधूतं परिजना सहितं कृष्ण चैतन्य देवं श्री राधा कृष्ण पदान सहगणा निदिता श्री विशाखामृतांश नमाम विष्णु पादाय कृष्ण पृष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमदे भक्ति वेदांत स्वामिनिते नामिने नमस्ते सरस्वते देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेष श्रीवादी पाश्चात देशकाय नमो महावदन्याय कृष्ण प्रेम प्रदाय कृष्णाय कृष्ण चैतन्य नामिने हे कृष्ण करुणा सिंधु दीन बंधु जगतपते गोपेश गोपिका कांत राधा कांत नमस्ते सप्त कांचन गौरांगी राधे वृंदावनेश्वरी ऋषभानु सत्य देवी प्रणमामे हरि प्रिय वांछा कल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपा सिंधुभ्येव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौर भक्तवृंद हरे कृष्णा कृष्ण कृष्ण हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे। सो दिस एंटायर इंसिडेंट विच हैपेंड द असेंबली ऑफ दक्ष देयर्स लॉट ऑफ स्ट्रेस and even though Lord Shiva, we as a Gaudiya Vaishnavas do not count Lord Shiva as one of the demigod, we respect him as a Vaishnava, as a pure devotee of Lord. But nonetheless, he has a role to play as a demigod, and all the demigods are also Vaishnavas. Not everyone may be a pure devotee, but they are all devotees of Lord Vishnu. There's a meaning of Devata. Vishnu Bhakta Bhave Devata. Anyone who is a devotee of Vishnu is a Devata. So, a lot of stress is, even Lord is laying stress on giving the bhaga or the, you know, prasad to Lord Shiva also from the yajna. Now someone may ask that is it not demigod worship? It appears that in the Bhagavatam, by the example of Daksha, Lord Vishnu is trying to teach us demigod worship. Yes. It appears like that. But then you have to understand what is the meaning of demigod worship. Even in Bhagavad Gita, in the 3rd chapter and 10th canto, Lord is saying that I have created these demigods, also created human beings, and I have given the knowledge to human beings in the scriptures that all of you should worship demigods and please them, and in return they will give you the necessary facilities to live in this world. And in this way you can have all the facilities in this world and practice bhakti to me, and at the end of your life come back home back to Godhead. This is in Bhagavad Gita. So what actually Lord is trying to say? Should we go and worship the demigods? But in the other case, we see in 10th canto, Lord Krishna told to Nanda Baba that these demigods like Indra is doing his own duty. He is not doing any favor to us by giving us rains. That is his duty. So why should we worship Indra? Rather, we should worship Govardhan. Because Govardhan is actually doing for us. So there, Lord Krishna is telling not to worship Indra. And here we see Lord Vishnu personally coming and giving the offerings of the yajna to Shiva, to Indra, to Chandra. Everyone should get. So what exactly is this demigod worship? And in Bhagavad Gita, Krishna is saying, Kamasthartaritajnana devat parpadyante anya devata. Those who are less intelligent, they worship the demigods. How do we understand? There are apparently contradictory statements in Bhagavatam and Bhagavad Gita. But Srila Prabhupada, in his purports, very clearly explains this concept. Anywhere the worship of demigod comes, Prabhupada very clearly puts the point that what is actually the meaning of demigod worship. Like in this purport also. So it's very aptly spoken by Maitreya, by Maitreya Muni, that how we should worship demigods, but we have to understand what is their position. And then Prabhupada in the purport writes about Bhubaneswar temple and Jagannath Puri temple. Anyone of you who would have visited Jagannath Puri temple, you would have seen this temple of Bimala Devi. There's a very beautiful pastime where Lord Parvati became angry because Narad Muni got Mahaprasad of Lord Narayan and he shared some with Lord Shiva. But Shiva didn't share this with Parvati. So Parvati became angry. She said, I am your Ardhangani. I am like half of your part. Whatever comes to you, you're supposed to share half with me. And how can you forget and not give me the Mahaprasad of Lord? So then she started doing tapasya, severe penances, and everything was getting, the world was heading towards destruction. Lord Vishnu personally came and he said, Devi, leave this tapasya. Whatever, I'm telling the story in short, you would have heard this. Whatever amount of prasadam you want, I will directly give from my plate, don't worry. So any one of us would get this Mahaprasada, we would be happy. That we are anyways happy when we get deities, but we still we don't realize that deities are Lord Himself. When we realize, we will have more value for prasadam. One who realized this, that the deity of Radha and Krishna in ISKCON temple is non-different from Lord Himself, then we can appreciate the value of prasadam more. Imagine, you know, you're sitting and chanting your rounds early in the morning and suddenly Lord Narayan appears. 400 form. Beautiful form of Lord. Holding this Shankha Chakra and Gada and the flower in his hand. Very mesmerizing smile on his face. Compassionate looks, and he tells you that, my dear child, take whatever quantity of Mahaprasad you want directly from my plate. What will be our reaction? We'll go crazy. We'll not be able to control our emotions. Like Dhruva, when he saw Lord Vishnu in front of him, he was not able to speak. Stubbed. He became completely stunned. That will what will happen. That happens with many devotees. Then, but Parvati was not happy. Parvati said, I don't want this Mahaprasad only for me. I want now you to give Mahaprasad to all my children. That means we. The conditioned living souls in the material world are children of Parvati. So then Lord says, okay, in Kali Yuga, I will appear as Lord Jagannath in Jagannath Puri, and my prasad, when it will come out of the temple, the first offering will go to Bimala Devi. Any prasadam comes out from Lord Jagannath temple till today, first goes to Bimala Devi. And then it is distributed through Anand Bazar to everyone. So this is how we are getting prasadam, because long ago, somewhere in mountain Kailash, Mother Parvati compassionately asked or requested Lord Vishnu to give prasad to all of us. And we are able to relish Lord Jagannath Prasadam. So this is how we are getting prasadam. And till today, it is mentioned in the purport that the prasad first goes to Bimala Devi. And similarly, in the Lingeshwar temple, Lord Shiva's temple, Lingaraj in Bhubaneswar. So there is a big Lingaraj temple, 1,000 lingas. And just adjacent to that is Lord Vishnu's temple. Main temple is Bhubaneswar, the name itself is Bhubaneswar, is given to, this area is given to Lord Shiva, and he guards Jagannath Puri. Anyone has to go to Jagannath Puri has to pass through Bhubaneswar. So Lord Shiva is the guard, and so he has a temple there. But there is also a temple of Lord Vishnu. So whatever offerings to come out from Lord Vishnu's temple, first go to the Lingaraj. Now this is the exact an accurate meaning of demigod worship. Worship of Mother Parvati is happening in Jagannath Puri temple. But how? By offering her the remnants of Lord Jagannath. You see? Whatever is cooked, Krishna says, that I am the master of everything and controller. So everything should be utilized in service of Krishna. So whatever is cooked in Jagannath Puri first goes to Lord Jagannath. So this is the meaning of demigod worship. Now what happens, especially in India, people who do not know, they consider Lord Krishna also as one of the gods. And demigods also gods. Kaun Bhagwan hai? Sab Bhagwan. Everyone is God in India. Human being is also God. Animals are also God. Plants are also God. Demigods are also God. And they count Krishna amongst all one of them. Everyone is God. There's no understanding. And then some of us were also attracted to some different kinds of demigods, mostly to Lord Shiva, Ganesha, the popular demigods, Durga, the popular. And some are attracted to Lord Krishna or Vishnu, but they don't have proper understanding that how Lord Krishna is the supreme, Shadashwarya Purna, supreme Lord. Then we come to ISKCON. There are atheists, we are not talking about that. Mostly people are believer of God. Then we come to ISKCON, we understand Krishna is supreme. But then sometimes we go to another extreme. We become extremist, saying that Krishna should only be worshipped. And all others should be not worshipped, should be because sometimes we have seen devotees that even neglect demigods. That's not what Prabhupada said. We don't have to open a temple of Indra or Chandra or Surya or Lord Shiva or Brahma, because they are all servants of Lord Krishna, once you worship Lord Krishna, everyone gets their share. We don't have to do separate worship to them. But there are temples of demigods, bona fide temples. Demigods do exist. It's not an illusion, they do exist. So the balanced approach, and Prabhupada writes, this is the Vaishnava principle. This is the Vaishnava philosophy. The balance, the proper understanding. And Prabhupada writes, the Vaishnava does not deride even ordinary living entities, including a small ant. Many times in Bhagavatam and Chaitanya Charitamrita, there is mention about the ant. How this Mrigari was there in Chaitanya Mahaprabhu tells the story how the Mrigari was there who used to kill animals, half kill animals. And now he's seeing that ants are there on the road and he's cleaning the road before he actually walks so that this ant should not die. Jada Bharat is looking constantly on the road if there are any ants or not before I put my foot, otherwise they'll die. So they are Vaishnavas. This is Vaishnava principle. We understand that every living entity, whether conditioned or liberated, is a part and parcel of Lord Krishna. As much as we are part and parcel of Krishna, all the living entities are part and parcel of Krishna. So why we should disrespect? Sometimes new people, they get connected to ISKCON, they understand this philosophy that Krishna is supreme. They don't even look at the demigod temple. If you see in India, I don't know about abroad, anywhere ISKCON temple is there, you will find nearby some Lord Shiva's temple will always be there. Everywhere we have seen, at most of the cases, Lord Shiva is already there. Wherever we find the place, it appears that we are looking for the place, we purchase the place, and then we open the ISKCON temple. No, it is guidance of Krishna. Krishna is guiding. It is Krishna who is guiding the devotees where the temple, where he wants to appear. And nearby, there will be temple of Lord Shiva, who is the protector or the Kshetra Palak. So I personally seen, like in ISKCON Juhu, where I stay, just bang opposite our temple, is Lord Shiva's temple. A very old temple. Before even Srila Prabhupada purchased this land of Hare Krishna land, purchased this land, Lord Shiva's temple was there. Now one extreme is that we don't even look there. Sometimes devotees just walk, they just turn the face opposite side. They don't even want to look inside the temple. And another extreme is every day we take some belpatra and water or milk and go and offer to Lord Shiva. These both are extremes. So proper understanding of demigod worship is mentioned in this. But sometimes we become offensive, even to Lord Shiva. And we have to suffer like Daksha. Mahaprabhu, whenever he traveled, he visited. If there was a temple of Lord Shiva, he will go inside and dance. Whether it was Bhubaneswar, many temples of Lord Shiva. He visited Trambakeshwar in Nasik. He visited temples of Durga also. In Mumbai, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu came to Mumbai. He visited Mumba Devi temple. He didn't go to Mahalakshmi temple. Lakshmi is his wife. How can he dance in front of his wife? He cannot pay obeisances to his wife. So, in the connected pastime. Advaita Acharya, in his childhood, was a friend of king's son. The king of that area had a son and he was very close friend of Advaita Acharya. So once he took Advaita Acharya to the temple of Durga and he paid obeisances. And he told Advaita Acharya to pay obeisances to the deity of Durga. Advaita Acharya didn't pay obeisances. He's Mahavishnu. He's Sadashiv. Durga will never accept obeisances. She's like, you know, it's against the principle of religion. So he didn't pay obeisances. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, when he came to Mumbai, he visited Mumba Devi temple, the temple of Durga. And he danced. And wherever Lord Shiva's temple was there, he would visit. Whether it is Rameshwaram, Bhubaneswar, or it is Trimbakeshwar, or in South India, many other temples. Shiva Kanchi he visited. Especially in India, you will find a lot of Shiva temples. He is Ashutosh, very easily pleased. And sometimes we as ISKCON devotees, without having proper understanding, we offend Lord Shiva. Oh, this is Lord Shiva's temple, why should we go inside? We should not even look, the demigod. Lord Shiva is not demigod. He's Param Vaishnava, topmost Vaishnava. But on the other side, we go to demigod and we say, oh my Lord Shambhu, oh Lord Shiva, you are all in all. You are Trimbakeshwar, you are Bhubaneswar. Yes, he has these names. You are everything. Please give me this benediction. So anyone who goes to demigods and asks for benediction, they are demons. Material benediction. You see all, not in the, in the absolute sense, but you see this Ravana or who is it? Hiranyakashipu. They go to Brahma and Shiva. But when a Vaishnava, when a devotee visits demigod's temple and especially Shiva's temple, there are temple of Durga and Ganesh, but maximum temple of Lord Shiva you will find in India. So when we visit the Vaishnava principle, we pay obeisances. Vancha kalpataru vishya kripa sindhuvayacha patita nam pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo namo namaha. The topmost Vaishnava, we consider him Vaishnava, we dance in front of him. He is the Guru, he is the Acharya. And then we also ask benediction. When we go to great personalities, if you don't ask them, it's an insult. When Narasingadev killed Hiranyakashipu, he said, Prahlad, ask. Prahlad said, I don't want anything. No, no, you ask something. My dear Lord, I am not a businessman. That you kill someone and I will ask. Narasingadev said, no, you ask. Otherwise, my good name will be spoiled. It will be ruined. My reputation will be on stake. I am giving darshan to someone and that person is not asking. It is an insult. It's like you are in America and you know your president comes to that area and he does not give some benediction. Okay, bring electricity to this part, good roads, infrastructure and this facility. If he doesn't give, that's an insult to him. So when we go to temple of Lord Shiva or Durga or Ganpati, we should ask something. Even when we go to in front of the deities, Sri Radha Krishna, we should ask something. It's an etiquette. First we should, but there are proper way. First we should pray. After paying obeisances, we should pray. We should glorify. We should pay obeisances, we should glorify the deity, whoever is the personality, whether it's Lord Krishna, Lord Ram, Gaur Nithai, Lord Shiva, we should glorify them with proper understanding. We don't go to Ganapati temple and say, my Lord, you are the creator, you are the master of three worlds. We don't do that. Brahma Samhita, it is said that you are the Vighna Vinashak, You are the remover of obstacles. How you do that? Because on your head, on your tumuli, you hold the lotus feet of Lord Narsingadev. Lord Ganesha is a devotee of Narsingadev, like Lord Shiva is a devotee of Shankarshan, Baldev. So then we glorify him like that. We glorify Lord Krishna as the Supreme Absolute Truth. Krishna, Ram, or Gaur Nitai, or Narayana, Vishnu. And we glorify Shiva as Param Vaishnava. After glorifying, then we ask something. Then we pray. Ask for a benediction. So according to Vaishnava principle, if you go and ask benediction to Lord Shiva, that is okay. But we don't ask, Jai Jagadish Hare, you give me this Sukha Shanti Gharave Dukha Mat Hatetan. They have these prayers, no, in India, that you give me all the facilities, you give me material happiness, and distress should go away from my life. But what Vaishnava will ask? My dear Lord Shiva, you are the topmost Vaishnava, 24 hours absorbed in the holy name of Lord Vishnu, Lord Krishna. You are immersed in the pastimes. Please give me a drop of your mercy so that I can also chant and perform bhakti yoga and do some service for the mission of Lord. That benediction we ask. That you can call demigod worship. But what Prabhupada condemns, or what Krishna condemns in Bhagavad Gita, is demigod worship for the materialistic purpose without understanding the proper position of the demigod and considering that particular demigod as all in all the supreme absolute truth. That is condemned. If you go and tell any demigod or any other personality apart from Lord Krishna that you are Supreme Absolute Truth, it's an insult to him. It's a sarcasm. Suppose you do something and someone, you achieve something, you get some good result. Oh, You are so great. You are like you are temple president. You are founder acharya of the movement. You are not founder acharya of ISKCON. But if someone is telling you, you don't become happy. You understand this fellow is pulling my leg. He is using sarcastic language. So when anyone calls any other personality apart from Lord Krishna as the Supreme Absolute Truth, these personalities, they become they get offended. So an offense, it is an offense to call Ganesha, Ganpati, or Shiva, or Brahma, or Chandra, or Indra as the Supreme God. Because they are not. That is the position. But if you actually glorify them according to their position, they are happy. They'll give you benediction. And then Krishna is condemning the karma kanda process that you go to demigod and ask for material benediction. That is condemned. Because that actually they are not giving. Avidhi purvakam, Krishna says. Even if you want material benediction, what Indra will give, what Chandra will give, what Surya will give? They are all part and parcel of Krishna. So actually Krishna will give. So go to Krishna. And that's what Krishna says. Chaturvidha bhajante mam guna sukrita na arjuna. Artho arthaarthi jigyasu jnanija bharadarshava. Anyone who comes, the four categories of people come to me. Those who are distressed, those who want money, those who want knowledge, those who are seeker of truth. So we should understand the proper position. Like Lord Krishna, when he came to Hastinapur, Lord Krishna, when he came to Hastinapur, he met all the five Pandavas. So he touched the, and Kunti, he touched the feet of Kunti. and also touched the feet of Yudhishthira. With Bhima and Arjuna, he embraced them. And Nakul and Sahadev, they touched the feet of Krishna. Even though Krishna Supreme Lord was, he is playing the role of a human being. So, Kunti is aunt of Krishna. And Yudhishthira is like an elder brother. So, Krishna does not embrace Yudhishthira. Krishna does not allow Yudhishthira to touch his feet, even though Yudhishthira knows that Krishna is Supreme Lord. Krishna goes and touches the feet. That's a proper understanding of the relationship. When Narada Muni visited Dwarka in the 16,000 palaces of Krishna to see Krishna's wonderful opulence, he goes to every palace. In every palace, Krishna welcomes Narada Muni, make him sit on the higher seat and then washes his feet. Even though Narada knows that Krishna is Supreme Lord, but Narada does not want to disturb the Leela. So it's a proper understanding. So if we have proper understanding and give respect to demigod, what to talk of demigod? They are powerful managers. Like in our temple, we have Prabhupada said there should be a temple president. There should be a treasurer, the accountant. There should be a temple commander. Now, temple commander is practically hands-on temple president only. He has all the power. But still, temple president is temple president. Temple president is engaged in the preaching or in expanding the mission, creating the vision for the temple, and he meets big people. And on the hands-on management, all done by temple commander. All the devotees, they interact with temple commander. But he is not temple president. That's the relationship we should understand. So these demigods are powerful managers for Lord Krishna, and they assist Lord Krishna in managing the universal affair. Even though Lord Krishna does not need them, he engages every one of us. From demigod to all of us, Krishna engages for our own purification. So when we go to ISKCON temple, ideally, even as a congregational member, we stay away. If we go once a week, that's why Srila Prabhupada started the Sunday Love Feast. It's for new people, it's for old people. Devotees. So when we go to temple, we take up some service, we execute the service. The temple management and the temple and Srila Prabhupada, they are doing a favor on us by giving us service. The only way we can advance spiritually is by service. So the temple devotees, the management is thinking how to create more services so that more devotees can be engaged. So we should be very grateful and thankful to the system, to the temple management, that they are creating services for us. We should not think that we are doing favor on temple. So demigods are very thankful and grateful to Krishna because Krishna has created service for them, even though Krishna does not need to take service from anyone. But for the purification, they are given services. Rishikena Rishikesha Sevanam Bhakti Ruchate. What is bhakti? When we use our senses in the service of the master of the senses. So that is why we should try to at least once a week visit and do some service. Because that service done in ISKCON temple is direct service to the mission of Lord, is direct service to Prabhupada, direct service to Lord Krishna. Prabhupada said, all my temples are Vaikunthas. They are not in this material world. Similarly, demigods are very powerful living beings who are given this post, like Indra. He practically controls the entire universe. even though Brahma is the secondary creator of the universe, Brahma is more engaged in austerity, in bhajan, and Indra is doing all the management. And Shiva only comes when the destruction is required, or he gives the benediction. And Surya is doing his role. So they are helping Krishna or assisting Krishna in the universal affair. So we cannot disrespect them, but they are serving with Krishna. That's what Srila Prabhupada said. We don't even disrespect an ant on the road. But we should not mistake them to be the supreme, powerful living entities. They are powerful, but they are not supremely powerful. Supremely powerful is only Krishna. So that is the meaning of demigod worship. This is important to understand the principle. The share according to their position. Just give the respect according to the position. It's like if there is, suppose you go to ISKCON temple nearby and you see there is one sannyasi, Prabhupada disciple, one Maharaj has come. And there's another devotee who's also a sannyasi, who's Maharaj, but he's a grand disciple of Prabhupada. Like he is a disciple of Srila Prabhupada. So obviously you will go and pay obeisances to first the senior sannyasi, who is Prabhupada's disciple. So giving respect as per the position is Vaishnava etiquette. This is one of the etiquette parameters which we follow. So similarly, when we may not need to go to Lord Shiva's temple for material benediction, but we go, like from Bombay, Nasik is only like 3-4 hours. So sometimes we go for a small yatra, a camp, we take sometimes students or congregation or brahmacharis. And we go visit the different places where Lord Ramchandra performed his leela. And he cut the nose, Lakshman cut the nose of Shurpanakha, that is where the place is known as Nasik. And we also visit Trimbakeshwar. And there is also a beautiful kshetra, Taket, near Nasik, where Jatayu fought with Ravana and laid down his life in the service of Lord Ram. That the place is there. And then we go to Jagannath Puri. We also visit to Bhuvaneshwar. We go to Lingaraj temple, Shiva's temple. But with the proper understanding of his position and not seeking any material benediction. So Vaishnavism does not teach us extremism. Anything goes in extreme is materialism, is material concept. Vaishnavas are always balanced in approach. So we do not worship demigod for material benefit, considering them as supreme absolute truth. And we do not completely deride or reject demigods. We give them their position. We give them their respect. They are much more powerful than us and devoted than us. Just because we are chanting, we are initiated, does not mean that we are higher than demigods. They are at a much higher position. They are also performing bhakti. We are also doing, some of us are doing karma mishrit bhakti, some are doing jnana mishrit bhakti. Only very rare we get some souls who perform pure devotional service. So if we disrespect, that will consider as an offense. So here it is mentioned that. We don't have to specially go, but we are going and we see Lord Shiva's temple, okay, pay obeisances and go ahead. Ask a benediction so that we can chant our rounds nicely. Lord Shiva is always engaged in chanting. So much focus he would have had, imagine. Lord Shiva has so much focus and attention in his chanting, so we can ask his mercy so that we can also attentively chant our 16 rounds at least. So this is what Prabhupada is writing. in his purport. And next few verses, he's talking about how, from where Maitreya heard this story, and how when Sati, committed suicide, left her body, then she took birth in Himalayan mountains as a daughter of Parvat Raj and daughter of Meena or Menaka. Then she took birth as Parvati, daughter of Parvat Raj, Parvati, and again she married Lord Shiva. She is an eternal consort of Lord Shiva. This is the form changes. So this is how this chapter and these seven chapters, they end talking about the severe consequences of offending a Vaishnava. So we should try to protect ourselves from offending a Vaishnava, and we should smoothly sail sitting in the boat of ISKCON towards Vaikuntha. Hare Krishna. Any comments or questions?
Krishna Vibhuti Dhanatanam.
Yes, Mataji.
Yes. Excellent lecture, very well explained. Prabhuji, I just have two questions. One question relates to demigod worship, and the second one relates to blasphemy of devotees. The first question is, there are some people whom we try to preach in the movement. Eventually, they accept the supremacy of Lord Krishna, but they are unable to give up the demigod worship completely, the way we do when we move ahead in Krishna consciousness. So how do we deal with them? And second, the question relates to blasphemy of devotees. In whatever lectures that I have heard previously, or I have read, if I'm not able to connect, we should avoid blasphemy of Krishna. But again, reality is presented to them. So constructive criticism needs to be applied. So that can put them off, but is it wrong on our part, or is it the right mood of letting them know how things should be?
Okay, so your first question, that there is someone who is a demigod worshipper or a devotee of demigod, some particular demigod.
Mm-hmm.
Now he becomes a devotee, or he is becoming a devotee, started chanting, but he is attached to his deity, maybe Lord Shiva, maybe Shivling or Ganpati or Mother Durga, possible. So we don't disturb them. We tell them, okay, you worship Lord Krishna, you have Jagannath, Baldev, Subhadra, Gaur, Nitai, deities, or you have photo of Lord Krishna, worship. And after performing the arati, you show the arati to the demigod. Like we show to Prabhupada. And then you offer bhoga to Krishna and then give the prasadam to your deity. Maybe Lord Shiva, maybe Lord Ganesh. That's okay. And gradually when he'll become more and more advanced, he'll give up. I know one devotee, initiated devotee, very senior congregation devotee in our Juhu temple. He was a worshipper of Durga, Devi, Kula Devi, and mother, father, everyone was there. So they have a deity. And now he has bigger deity of Jagannath, Baldev, Subhadra on the altar, and on the side of Baldev, smaller deity of Durga is also there. So he worships. He is like, you know, worshipping Lord Jagannath, Baldev, Subhadra. Huge deity he has at his home. I visited there. Huge deity of Lord Jagannath. He worships Lord Jagannath, Baldev, Subhadra, and then gives the arti at the end to Durga and offers the bhoga to Jagannath and gives the prasadam to Durga, which is authorized, not a problem. If somebody is attached, not able to leave, okay, let him continue, but he should have a proper understanding. You should have a proper understanding. Then it's okay, no problem. Unnecessarily, if we preach little strongly or against these things, then eventually they may not become devotees, they will leave also. And this has happened many times. This is because we become very extreme. We have to understand the concept. What is the harm? If he shows the ghee lamp to Jagannath and then Baldev and Subhadra and then Sudarshan and then to Lord Shiva and then to Prabhupada, there is no harm. He is doing as per scriptures. And then gradually he will learn that yes, I may worship Lord Shiva, but let me not ask him material benediction. Let me ask him more bhakti. So that is okay. No issues. And another thing about constructive criticism and blasphemy, these are two different things. Blasphemy is done out of envy. And constructive criticism, or I will say correction, is given out of compassion. Most of the time we become blasphemous to devotees whom we envy. Some devotee has got some position, a number of devotees. Okay, one devotee in the society, he has 10 followers. I only have 8 followers. And then someone glorifies that devotee and our heart is burning and we say, what is the big deal? Number is not important. He has 10 followers. What is the use? The quality is not so much. So that is called blasphemy because we are envious. Because what he has, we want that. That is envy. And correction is completely non-envious. Only a non-envious soul should give correction. Compassionate. Even a mother. We talk sometimes, this is a Kali Yuga effect. Your mother, if you have your child, now don't do it in America. It's a crime. You can be in trouble. A small child, 4 years old, and if he's too much mischievous, you slap him. Do you need to ask anyone before slapping? Do you need to think, whether I'm envious or I'm compassionate, whether I should give him correction or not? You just, mother, because mother has complete love and compassion for the child, and she is the best well-wisher of the child. To child won't mind also. Being corrected by mother. And mother will also not think. And that's what I'm saying. America is a little different. In India, they don't think. Why? Whatever she is doing, that's what Yashoda showed. Yashoda didn't consult Nanda Baba. Yashoda didn't consult all the panchayat and all the leadership of the Vraja. That my son is doing all this mischief. Shall I bind him or not? She just took the rope and the stick and chase him all through the village with a stick behind him because she is well-wisher. So if you want to correct someone, you have to have a non-envious heart, anyone. You have to have compassion in your heart. And most important, you should have a relationship with that devotee and he should have some faith on you. Otherwise, even if you correct, without humility, it's not an offense. Even if that devotee becomes a little upset, that's not an offense. But you didn't do any service. That's not a service because he will not follow you. Whatever correction you have given, he will not rectify himself because he doesn't respect you. He does not have faith on you. He does not have a relationship with you. And maybe you didn't do with proper humility and compassionate and a non-envious way. I'm just taking you as not you, but anyone who's giving correction.
You can take me because it relates to me. I was very direct in my approach. So I was told that, Mataji, you are not happy with anything. I was, maybe I was too direct. So henceforth, the particular person and his followers told me, Mataji, learn to be more diplomatic, you know. If anybody asks you, how was the program? Yeah, it was good. How was the prasad? It was good. How were the devotees? It was good. How is ISKCON? It is good. How is everything? It is good. How are the demons? It is good. You should never never find fault, because probably constructive criticism is not the right perspective when you attend something for the first time and you pinpoint. After attending for a number of months, then you have the right to constructive criticism.
Yes.
So I understand this, that, you know, then this is being superficial, it can affect the bhakti level also. Being superficial,
yes,
will affect.
Perfect. Now see, is this the first time you are hearing my class, or you have heard my class before also?
I believe you are His Grace Chakrapani Prabhu.
Chakravarti. Yes.
I have attended your class before, yes.
So you attended my class. Even if you are attending first class, you heard me for 45 minutes.
Yes.
So when you,
yes,
hear from someone, you develop a faith and,
right,
some kind of relationship. And,
right,
if you ask me, that means you opened your heart because you have some faith on me. And then I give you some suggestion.
Right.
But nothing happened, and suddenly you come and I meet you and I say, what are you doing? Is this the way to read Bhagavatam? Is this the way to chant? Is this the way you are applying tilak? Then you will be like shocked. Who is he? And in the heart with him. Who is this fellow coming and directly telling me? So then people will not accept it. People will not accept your correction. So it will not have any value. So you don't have to be diplomatic. You keep distance. Diplomacy is something different. It's like, you know, you are going first time to some program and you are told to give feedback and you give everything honest without any relationship. That's the problem. A mother has so much relationship with the child. Child has complete trust on mother. And then mother can give correction. So similarly, guru can give correction. Shiksha Guru, Diksha Guru, manager, temple president, they are like fathers. They can give correction. So before giving correction, you have to invest something, invest your consciousness, and then the other person will develop some faith. Then they will listen to you. And then your correction will have some value also. Otherwise, you speak even honestly, that will have no value. I mean, he will not change, that person, he or she may not change. So what is the use of giving correction to that person?
Right. Thank you so much, Prabhuji. It was very enlightening. Thank you. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji. Dhanat pranam, all glories to Srila Prabhupada and Guru Maharaj. Thank you so much, Prabhuji. Especially my Mataji's question was very enlightening. And all the class also is very inspiring, especially in the demigods. Sometimes we don't have proper understanding, and we offend the demigods and their devotees. I have also one question related to Mataji's question, Prabhu. If we just like, if we meet somebody, or if we want to do the house program or Bhakti Vrishya, anything, that time, Prabhu, how we should approach, means we directly say about Krishna consciousness. I mean, and if we want to have a relationship with the materialist people, we should also be like that. I mean, it's not possible. Mostly it's very difficult in the beginning, mingle with them. We should have certain distance also. And then and when we call them in Bhakti Vichar House program, we will tell, I mean, we'll tell about Krishna, everything, but how we should deal with them, Prabhu. I mean, we will tell, but they may not appreciate all these things. How we should deal, Prabhu?
Suppose you are a doctor and you go to a patient who is infected with a disease, contagious disease. The patient is kept separately. And now, as a doctor, you have to visit that patient and treat him. So, what is the first thing when you are going to the person who has a very dangerous, deadly, contagious disease, what preparation you have to do before actually you go and see him? What is the preparation you have to do?
You wear a gown, gloves, mask.
Yeah. We should be at least be careful to get that disease.
So you will kind of have a shield which will protect you from that disease. And that, as a preacher, you have to also protect your consciousness when you deal with these materialistic people. You must deal with them. You have to deal with them. Whether for preaching or for business or for job or for any other thing, this world is filled with materialistic people. You have to deal. So this morning program, chanting and Mangal Aarti and Guru Puja and Bhagavatam class is like a shield which will protect. So that is the first thing. If you have not chanted your rounds and not attended Bhagavatam class or read Bhagavatam class, how can we think of going out and preaching? That means we are going to commit suicide. So this is one. Now you completely covered yourself and protected with the shield against that contagious disease. Now you go to the patient and you are talking to patient. You are examining the patient. You to see what is the level of disease. And then you start treating the patient. After some time you realize that your shield is becoming weak. And some infection of patient is coming onto your body. What will you do immediately?
Take a shower.
Immediately, first of all, go from there. So when you are preaching to a person who is not devotee, excuse me, when you are preaching to a non-devotee, you are supposed to transfer your consciousness to that person. You are the doctor, you should have the medicine. A doctor does not go to patient to take the infection from the patient. A doctor goes to patient to give the medicine. So medicine is with the doctor, not with the patient. So when the preacher goes to a materialistic person, the preacher has to transfer the consciousness to materialistic person. And in the dealing to preach, if you sense, and only you can sense this when you have a very strong morning program, especially Japa and Bhagavatam. If you cannot hear Bhagavatam class, listen to audio class if you cannot read Bhagavatam. Best is if you have Mangal Aarti also and Guru Puja also. 100% morning program means 40% is for Japa, 30% is for Bhagavatam, 20% is for Mangal Aarti and 10% is for Guru Puja. This is 100% morning program. This is a formula. 40% for Japa, 30% for Bhagavatam, 20% for Mangal Aarti, Tulsi Aarti, Narsingh Aarti, and then 10% for Guru Puja. This is 100% Bhagavatam morning program. Only when you do this program, when you are dealing with a materialistic person in the daytime, and when you see the consciousness of materialistic person which is contaminated is transferring from him to you, which will contaminate you, you can immediately sense it and you say, I have some work. Somehow or the other, just leave that place for that time because you are becoming weak and you can be contaminated with that disease. And you become weak, you cannot preach, rather you will be preached by that materialistic person. So immediately leave that place. Go and take a shower with the holy name, with the Bhagavatam, hear a lecture, associate with devotees, again purify our consciousness, go again next day and preach. That is why we want, Prabhupada said, this transcendental sandwich formula. Morning program, evening program. Morning spiritual program, evening spiritual program. And the daytime you are with materialistic people. So evening if you can have Gaur Aarti, good. If you cannot have Gita class, if you cannot have anything in the evening because working and all that, this, that, at least you can have some Krishna book reading before you sleep. At least you can discuss some Krishna katha. If you are at home and cooking and eating prasadam, play some lecture, play some kirtan. That is evening program. So morning spiritual, evening spiritual, daytime preaching, mission. And when you follow this, even the daytime mission will also become spiritual because you're just spreading spiritual consciousness. And then morning, afternoon, evening will all become spiritual. The night you will take rest, that also will be considered spiritual. In that way, 24 hours you'll be Krishna conscious, very easy. So that is how you can protect yourself. So good morning program is the key that you go out and infect others with your transcendental consciousness and not get contaminated by their materialistic consciousness. So do your morning.
Prabhuji, also I'm thinking because how it's necessary, because even though we do our program, means chanting, morning program, and how it's how much is it important to give Krishna consciousness, because sometimes what happened, and then also my question is how we need to be strong in telling about Krishna. Sometimes we have to tell so many things to encourage them, just like yoga or whatever they have interest. Some people have interest in philanthropy, or some people have interest in yoga, or some we also talk in that topic, but how it's important to talk about Krishna. Because let them know about Krishna, and also how it's necessary to preach. Sometimes myself, oh, I don't need to at all consult with them and just be with devotees and chant myself. It's too hard. Maybe I cannot convince them at all. It's not my job, but still I pray to God every day. I pray to Krishna, Guru. This is you only can transport. It's not our job, my hand, but still is how much necessary, Prabhu. It's a very important, or how important, even though we are not qualified. Hare Krishna, Prabhuji is Hare Krishna, Prabhuji. Is anybody hearing?
Yeah, Hare Guru Mataji.
Oh, okay, Prabhuji is there, Mataji? I don't think so. I think Prabhuji is in line. Prabhuji's phone is mute. I don't know. Hare Krishna. Rajeshwari Mataji, do you know Prabhuji how we can get contact? The message, WhatsApp message or anything?
No, Mataji. I don't know. I don't know, Mataji. How did he join?
Okay, Mataji, let me connect him.
I think Prabhuji is him. Okay. I don't know. Yeah, you can just ask him what happened to Prabhuji. Because Samaguri Mataji is not today.
I have his number, I am patching him.
Okay. I can see Prabhuji in line, but his line is in mute. I don't know, maybe Prabhuji is not.
Yeah, Haribol.
Hare Krishna Mataji.
One minute.
नेटवर्क क्षेत्र
I don't know, Prabhuji. Otherwise, we can end the call or we can wait some time for Prabhuji. Prabhuji's line is there. Just let's wait some time, five minutes. And
stop the recording, Mataji, while we are waiting and then restart the recording.
What, Mataji?
We can stop.
Mataji, I'm not able to connect him. Let me try once more.
Okay, should I stop recording?
Stop the recording, Mataji, and then you can.
So we were talking, anyways. Sorry for this disruption.
Yes, thank you, Prabhu. I had a question. I was asking the question. Means while we were, how much is necessary to preach, and then how much is necessary to. Tell about Krishna. Means I was telling also. Sometimes the people have inclination to hear yoga, and then also kind of philanthropic work or these things also. At the same time, how much we know according to that we need to talk, because we should not discourage what they have interest, but how much is necessary to connect with Krishna, and then. And also, I forgot Prabhu. Yeah, and it's...
I understood, Mataji.
Yes,
so we discussed, you understood this example of doctor which I gave you?
Yes, Prabhu, yeah.
So we don't have to limit our preaching. We can go and preach unlimitedly, but only we can preach when we are feeling very lot of strength, the spiritual strength. So for that, we have morning program, very pakka. And now people are interested in talking about philanthropy or yoga. You can start any matter. Prabhupada also spoke different matters. But shift the discussion gradually towards spirituality. If they are talking about this, yoga, it's very easy to connect yoga and Krishna consciousness. Prabhupada is written in Bhagavad Gita. If they want to talk about philanthropy, yes. Then also it's very easy to connect. So any and every subject matter in the entire universe can be connected to Krishna consciousness. That's what Prabhupada has taught us. If we hear Prabhupada's lectures and read Prabhupada's book, we'll understand how to connect that. Any topic they start, you can easily connect with Krishna consciousness. Absolutely no problem with that. And you can go and preach unlimitedly. Whole day you can preach. Do your morning program. Preach. No problem with that.
Prabhuji, I'm telling how much it's necessary, because sometimes I'm feeling at all not qualified, you know, means and so much of discouragement, the courage don't come, and we are not at all qualified in the, compared to them. They are some are very high qualified people, and then we want them to learn about Krishna consciousness, and then. Even though I tried
morning. Qualification, you are talking about spiritual qualification or material qualification?
Prabhu, both.
So spiritually, we are not qualified, that we know. You also know, I also know, everyone in the conference knows, no one of us is qualified. Qualification has come from Prabhupada and from Lord Gauranga. We are just servants. We are just instruments. So we do our duty. do not think about qualification. If you have chanted your round 16 rounds, sang Mangalarti, Narsingarti, Tulsiarti, Guru Puja, heard Bhagavatam lecture, you have got the qualification from Guru and Gauranga to go and you do your duty. Don't think about qualification. Now, about material qualification, you see Prabhupada, he was not even complete graduate, but he preached to many people. So when you talk to people based on your spiritual strength which has come from morning program and Guru Parampara, then people won't mind talking to you even they are materially qualified, because the more people are materially qualified, the more dissatisfied they are in their life, the more frustrated they are in their life. And if they see a simple devotee who may not be very materially qualified but is happy and face is the index of mind, that happiness can be seen on the face of devotees, the shining, Prabhupada said, moon-like devotees, moon-like faces of my devotees. So even big people, qualified businessmen and entrepreneurs, they will get influenced seeing that simplicity of the devotee. So we don't need material qualification. That's a myth. We don't need any material qualification to preach. We only need spiritual qualification which has been given to us mercifully by Srila Prabhupada and entire Guru Parampara. And we should protect ourselves by doing a strong morning program. Don't worry. And if you are feeling sometime lack of courage, lack of confidence, you go and preach along with one devotee who is very fired up, very courageous, he has a lot of confidence, he or she. Go along with that devotee for some days and then you will also build, because confidence and enthusiasm is very contagious. If you go with confident devotee who's nicely in good standards in preaching and in sadhana, then you also get infected with the disease of enthusiasm, and then you can eventually go alone and preach. Don't think about material qualification that is not required. Don't think about spiritual qualification that is already given to us.
And Prabhuji, yeah, we know what is here, like with and here devotee are not there to get inspiration or anybody. But the main things, my worry is sometimes what happened when we are trying to preach and we are not qualified, we are making them Krishna. Make them to Krishna away from, means we made them away from Krishna, means maybe we may preach maybe not rightly, and then sometimes there, I feel like that, because sometimes when we preach, maybe because they may, they are too much in Krishna consciousness, so maybe they have some interest or something, they may lose, I feel like that, bro. Even though, I feeling so much of, means always awareness, maybe sometimes we talk about Krishna and they may not like, and maybe they are too much feeling away, or I don't know, that kind of feelings comes.
Yeah, so we need association. We need association. We can go to temple and take association of senior devotees whenever, wherever possible. Otherwise, just by reading Bhagavatam also, you get so much association. Read more Bhagavatam, hear more Prabhupada lectures. Prabhupada is a powerful Mahabhagavatam Adhikari devotee, eternal associate of Krishna. You hear lot of his vani by his books, through his books and through his voice. Hear lot of voice. Let the Shabda of Prabhupada enter into your ears, into your heart, in your consciousness, which will completely purify and give you a lot of strength, and you will become like a lion in preaching, or the lioness in preaching. That is one association which no one can separate from you, is association, direct association of Prabhupada through his vani and through his books. Anyone and everyone in the world can get that association. That is sufficient.
Yes.
If you get extra, that is good. Otherwise, go for this Prabhupada association. Become powerful and spread the mission of Prabhupada.
Yes, Prabhu. Thank you so much. Give all of your blessing, Prabhu. Yeah, main thing is we need to have a courage from all the devotees. Thank you so much, Prabhu.
Thank you.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji.
Hare Krishna, Mataji.
As always, Prabhuji, thank you very much. Prabhuji, can you repeat the percentage for the morning program, the break that you gave us? 40% was japa.
40% is japa?
Yes.
Srimad Bhagavatam reading or hearing is 30%. 20% is Mangal Aarti, Narsingh Aarti, Tulsi Aarti. And 10% Guru Puja.
Okay, thank you. And also, Prabhuji, did you mention that when you
visit the Mataji, there is some disturbance. I'm not able to hear the sound very clearly. Everyone else can mute and only you can talk. We can hear clearly.
Yes, I think it's gone, Prabhuji.
Yes.
Prabhuji, in the Shiva, well, did you say that we should offer Vanchakalpa Tarubhya's prayers?
Yeah, to Lord Shiva, because he's Vaishnava, no? Vanchakalpa is for Vaishnava Pranam Mantra.
Yes, we should offer that prayer, right?
Yes.
Okay.
You can offer many other prayers to Lord Shiva, but if you do not know anything, you just pray Vanchakalpa Vaishnava Pranam Mantra.
Thank you, Professor.
So we'll stop here, 6:20.
Yeah, Hare Krishna Prabhuji, I have one question, sorry.
Okay, Mataji. Okay,
Mataji. Yeah. So Prabhuji, you mentioned in your lecture that as much as we are part and parcel of Krishna, that much other living entity, whether they are animal or in fact they are part and parcel of Krishna.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
So to respect them, to show our respect, we should not kill them, right?
Yes.
But there are certain conditions, as we all stay at home, that these small cockroaches, they are like...
That is known as Panchashunya Yagya. That is Panchashunya. That is like five kinds of killing you cannot stop. When you burn the stove or the fire to cook something, the germs are killed. When you walk, the germs are killed. When you broom, clean the house, the germs are killed. Prabhupada said you cannot avoid that. That's a part of material creation, the material nature. You should continuously chant Hare Krishna to protect yourselves. That's all.
Yeah, because sometimes people say that you are killing so much, you are earning so much sin.
No, that is okay. We are chanting it because that the intention is more important. You are not killing to kill them. It's an accident, you can say. When you are, if you are driving a car and some you know, a frog or a rat or a dog or a cat comes in front of your car, you will not be given imprisonment punishment, because there's an accident. Even if some by accident or in the self defense someone kills a human being, the Supreme Court, the higher court, will consider that. I may not give the tough punishment. So Krishna sees the intention. And you cannot avoid, there are some things which you cannot avoid. You cannot avoid walking, you cannot avoid talking, you cannot avoid cooking, you cannot avoid cleaning. These things you cannot avoid. So definitely this sin is there, but that is not taken very seriously, especially for the devotees. If you are chanting continuously Hare Krishna mantra, and you are cooking, you are cleaning, you are walking, the germs which are getting killed, they will get Sukriti by hearing, because they are hearing Hare Krishna Maha Mantra at the time of death. They will be promoted immediately to human beings. When we dance up and down in some kirtan, so many germs are getting killed on the road when we are dancing. But because they are being killed under the lotus feet of a Vaishnava who is performing Harinam Sankirtan, they will be elevated as human beings. So you are not doing sin, you are doing a service. So chant continuously.
Thank you so much for giving assurance. And Prabhuji, which yagya you were telling? Means like what is the name of this yagya?
Not yagya. It is a five kinds of sins which we cannot, five kinds of killing which cannot be avoided, not yagya.
Okay. Okay. And one more thing I wanted to ask, somehow I missed that when Advaita Acharya was asked to pay obeisances to Lord Shiva, he did not pay obeisances.
Lord Mother Durga.
To Mother Durga.
Yeah, so that is Leela. Lord Shiva is playing, Lord Gauranga is playing the role of, sometimes Lord Gauranga shows his original bhav also, that I am the Supreme Absolute Truth. So Advaita Acharya is showing that. Otherwise, Lord Ram is worshipping Shivaling also. So Gauranga also pays obeisances to Lord Shiva because he is playing the role of a devotee. I am saying that once it happened that Advaita Acharya wanted to show his position. So that is Leela.
Okay. Thank you so much, Prabhuji.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Srila Prabhupada ki jai.
Thank you so much, Prabhuji. We can pay our obeisances to His Grace Chakravarti Prabhu and all the devotees. Vansakalpataruvetya kripasatvivata patitanama pavanebhyo vaishnavebhyo
namo namaha.
Anantakoti Vaishnavabrinda ki jai. Thank you so much, Prabhuji. Very inspiring class.
Very nice class. Very nicely explained. Hare Krishna.